Good morning, Oakwood. Go ahead, stand up. We're going to sing some praise. This is the day that you have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in your name, and now your joy awaits my praise. I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. When I was down, you brought me out and set my feet on higher ground. So here I stand. You are my God, your faithfulness, my solid rock. I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the you have won. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love spoken over us. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us. Give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the battles you have won. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful.
Good morning and welcome everybody to Oakwood. If you are new here, we are so glad you're here. We're going to do a real quick video and then we'll get on with announcements right after. So you guys can take a seat.
My name is Mia Kane and I'm one of the co-founders, hosts, and musicians for Aspire Women's Events. Our team is counting down the days till we get to come to your church and partner with you for this amazing women's event. On March 19th, we'll be with you at Oakwood Church with Bible teacher, author, and speaker Barb Bruce, comedian Michelle Miller, and music by me, Mia Kane.
I can't wait to see you at the next Aspire Women's event as your Aspire Bible teacher. I love gathering women together where we can discover God's power, His truth, His provision, and His promises that will bring you hope and joy no matter where you're at in life. So come out and join us and let's celebrate together at the next Aspire Women's event.
Aspire is a one-night event packed with laughter, learning, stories, and music to encourage you, to equip you. I absolutely love what God does at these events. I've been witnessing it for the past 10 years, and I am so thankful that your church said yes. Yes to opening the doors, yes to volunteering with us, and yes to reaching out to those who need to learn laugh, and hear the gospel message of truth. That is what Aspire is. This is my invitation to you to invite your friends, your family, your neighbors, as your church continues to be a light in the community. So grab those tickets today, and we will see you there.
Hey, ladies. Good morning. So you just saw everything that you need to see about Aspire. 2 weeks from today, this sanctuary, we want to fill this with women where together we can study God's word. So they're traveling here. It's not a video that we're watching. It's not streaming. They're going to be here live in our building. And so together we can sing and worship God together. We can laugh. You know, how about some laugh therapy? We have a comedian coming, a musician. It's going to be a great time. And for those of you that have children and sometimes you, we've had retreats in the past where you had to be away from your family for a couple days. This is only a 3-hour commitment. It starts at 5 o'clock. It ends at 8 o'clock right here. And so we're hoping that you'll be a part of it. All you have to do is hop on the Oakwood website, look under forms and events, and you'll see the Aspire event. To get registered, the tickets are $25 if you're doing general admission, but if you want to do VIP, which means you can come a half hour before the doors open, they're $35, and that gets you the opportunity to talk to an author, the Christian author, and maybe find out how they got started, who their publishers were, talk to the comedian, talk to the musician if you have questions. So please jump on the Oakwood website, get registered, bring your mother, bring your daughters, invite a neighbor, a coworker, and come here and have some fun. Have a great night of fellowship and studying God's word together. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Robin. As she just mentioned, I didn't even realize they are going to be here, right here. This is not Skype. This is not via video. So make sure you guys do that. You can go to oakwoodchurch.org/aspire. Make sure you sign up. Great time to invite somebody that doesn't know the Lord, too, to a cool event. That would be awesome. Also, guys, I hope you guys are all ready to have fun. I hope most of you signed up because today at 5 o'clock at the UAW Hall in Saline, we have our chili cook-off and talent show. You can, basically that starts at 4:30. Make sure you do get here before 5 o'clock if you've gotten your chili. Make sure to bring your best chili. It also says via name if you should bring a dessert or what you should bring. So make sure you check out the website for that. And see you guys today at that at 5 o'clock, 4:30 if you're bringing chili. If you have not taken OBC 201 Growing as a Christian, join us on Sunday, March 12th. You can sign up at go.oakwoodchurch.org/OBC201. The OBC classes are uber important. So if you have not taken them, even if you've been here for 10 years and you have not taken one of these classes, 201, please make sure you sign up for that. Finally, if you ever needed help getting signed up for things, we have a computer at the Welcome Center back there. And there is going to be somebody there to assist you if you need help getting signed up and basically downloading the app to your phone. And that will make it really, really easy to check out all these things that get signed up for stuff. All right, it's time to stand up. Welcome someone to Oakwood. Turn around, tell them how much you love them, and let's get back to worship.
That silence is the enemy. And let praise be the weapon that conquers all anxiety. Yeah. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. Let it rise. Let praise arise. Come on, together we sing. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. song. Let faith be the song that overcomes the raging sea. And let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise. Let faith arise. Let it rise. We'll see break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you.
Your help here. Come on, let's get them hands going this morning. Let's come to life. We serve a living God. Amen. Let's go. Here we go.
Now this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you. We praise you. And this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you. We praise you. And this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you. We praise you. And this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you. We praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you.
Church, let him hear you today. Yeah. Woo.
He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. He is the first, the last, the one who matters most. He is creator, ruling sustainer of all. He holds it all together. He is the Word of God, the hope for all the world.
You remember this from last week? Come on, let's sing it.
His name is lifted higher. Jesus, your name is lifted higher. We bless you, Lord, God of the ages, highest of all. Sustainer of all, he holds it all together. Yeah, he's the Word of God, the hope for all the world.
His name is lifted higher.
His name is lifted higher. Jesus, your name is lifted higher. greatest of all, we magnify you. Your name will be exalted, exalted. We bless you, Lord, God of the ages, highest of all.
You know, I got a chance this week talking to our Bible study on Thursday, our men's Bible study. I got the chance to tell them about a story of a client of mine that I've been dealing with that always asks me Bible questions, and that's fine. I'm always okay with that. They're believers, but they're new believers. And one of the things that they talked about was how they have a friend who's an atheist that is really, really trying to take them off the path and explain how they're wrong and how what they've read in the Bible is just incorrect. So they said, I want to put you on the phone with them. And you know, as a Christian, sometimes you're just not in the mood. All right? You're just not. And I was in that moment when they said, I want to put you on the phone with them. And I was trying to work and trying to do some stuff for the studio. And I said, all right, put them on the phone. Because I know God can move in any situation. Amen? No, 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 no. I want more than 10 of you to say amen this morning, okay? God can move in any situation. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, there's people out there today. He calls us to worship him, right? And so I said, put me on the phone with this atheist. I'll talk to him. So I get on the phone, and I could tell really quickly they were condescending. And you're supposed to share the love of Christ with those people. You're not supposed to try and be combative. You ain't gonna win that. So I said, you know what? You've been reading the Bible, right? He said, yes, I have been. And I've been writing down all my notes about what I think is wrong with it. And all my friends say I'm dancing with the devil. And I said, oh, you are so wrong. You are dancing with the Lord, my friend. I said, you are dancing with the Lord by reading his word. And I promise you, he will get you. And I told the Bible study to be praying for that. And I said, why don't you read the book of John, the book of love? Why don't you stop reading what you're reading and read the book of John, the book of love? And then let's talk maybe, right? And yesterday I was on my way to Scotty's house and my phone rings and I don't recognize the number. And guess who it was? It was that atheist. And they said, okay, listen. I'm not saying that I've crossed over. And I said, uh-huh. And he said, but I do have some questions. He said, I was young. I was mad at God. And I said, you were mad at who? Yes, I was mad at God. And I said, let's talk this week. And so I'm going to get with them and I'm going to talk with them. I promise you, our God, no matter what you're walking through, he is a friend to sinners. He is a friend to the lost. He is a friend to the broken. And it's your choice when he says, worship me in spirit and love. Worship me. Wake up, church. Wake up. You're at church. We get to worship him. What a friend we have in Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Friend we have in Jesus. sins and griefs to bear. For what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? See, we should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? See, Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within His presence. I speak Jesus.
And I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Do you believe that today? Fire. Come alive today. Here we go.
Now I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Yes, I do.
Over fear and all anxiety,
anxiety.
To every soul held captive by depression,
lift it up.
I speak Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family.
I speak the holy name.
Jesus. You know that's the name that makes demons flee. Oh!
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family.
I speak the holy name, Jesus.
It's Jesus.
Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name, Jesus. We exalt your name. Shout Jesus from ever been Jesus, the same name that healed in the Bible is the same name that heals and brings forth revival. See, I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. Oh, it's Jesus. Now what a friend we have in Jesus. Take it to God, we thank you that your name doesn't just bring forth the revival, it brings forth a victory in the church. Woo! It brings forth a victory in our life. It brings forth a victory in every aspect of this world when your name is spoken and believed and brought forth before the church, before the people, before the body, before this world, before the enemy. We've been reading our Bible study that says even the demons know his name.
Even your enemy who tries so hard to destroy you knows the power of your God. The God, the one and only true God. He knows. Even our enemies know. Father, we give you praise today. And as our pastor comes to speak, we ask that you would anoint his words. Set a fire in this room. Set a fire in our hearts. That we walk out of this room different than we are right now. We came in here with burdens. We came in here with struggles. We came in here with chains. Break them. Take the stripes off of us, Lord. Heal people who need healing. Save those that are lost. We pray this in your name, Jesus. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. If you are joining with us online, this is the part where we ask that you remain faithful and given as we take our offering and we come forward and ready for the next part of our service. We have the chili cook-off today at the Celine UAW Hall. Saturdays at 5, we have services. Sundays at 11:15 a.m. But if you get the chance today to come check out the chili cook-off variety show, you don't have to be super talented to jump in. But that's at 5 o'clock today. You got to get there at 4:30 to get your chili signed up. But we're going to ready for the next part of our service.
Okay, so let's ask the technical question we're all living with. Anyone in this room still without power at home? Still got a few that are missing it. We went 6 days without it, and we had a few in the congregation that went 8. And I announced to you last week that the pastor of your church, Baptist congregation, was without power. The pastor of the Methodist church was without power. Him and I decided who got it back on first. God loved them the most. I wanted you to know mine came back on Tuesday, his came back on Wednesday. God has made his statement, okay? I titled this today, Farmers and Guest, and it deals with a subject matter that is something that all of us have to work ourselves through and deal with the thought of what exactly, God, are you trying to say to us in Scripture in this setting and where he was. When I read this in the original Greek, in the where we are thing, it says in the original Greek that you're supposed to be at the chili cook-off this afternoon, okay? Everybody got that? And somebody came to me last night and they said, well, you can't register on a thing anymore, it's closed. And I said, whoopee, you still need to be there. If you're new, come and be with us, we'll have some fun together. Jesus was standing in a situation. We want to deal with the historical setting if we can. This parable that he's telling is one of the most dramatic that he's told of all the parables. It starts out with Jesus also told them other parables. To be able to take that, we have to put it in the setting of what's going on. He's dealing with a story about a royal wedding. He's dealing with a story about a royal feast. This is not a normal wedding. This is something that is beyond that. It's powerful and affects everyone in the community. It's a story that's told that's very specific in the thought process, but it broadens out and has this reaching allusion to every single one of us that are sitting in this room. The historical setting of when this is told, it's Wednesday. It is the last week of Jesus' life here on earth as God and man. On Friday, he's going to be crucified. On Sunday, he's going to rise from the dead. For 3 years, he's been teaching and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom. He's been offering himself to his own people, the people that are called the people of God, and they're not listening. They have rejected him. The Saturday before he arrives in Jerusalem for what's called the festivities of the Passover that's coming. Most of you are aware of that part of the story. But he also stays in Bethany, the home of Mary and Martha and Lazarus, people that he has become dear friends with. So when he wakes up Sunday morning, everyone's going through the normal things they're going through, but there is a massive crowd that has not just come for the Passover. They have come to be able to hear him. They've heard stories. They've heard about healings. They've heard all these powerful things, and they want to see it for themselves. So Monday comes, and he enters into Jerusalem through the Eastern Gate, riding a colt that, if you know anything about that time, that is symbolism of a military leader that's coming. And they're screaming Hosanna, they're screaming Hallelujah. Most of you have heard this story, you've seen it in pictures when you were a kid growing up. However, we don't wrap our brains around what really is going on. So you can put it in the setting that we all live in. I detest, can't stand, find it beyond vulgar, find it nasty beyond thought, and dumber and stupid than anything I see going on in our culture about idiots that want to become communist, socialism, Marxism, dumbbuttism. And yet there's people that want to live in that. Well, the day that you live in that regime, the day that you walk under something like China-controlled or Russia-controlled, you find out the hell that they've been living in forever. Bondage. You can't do your own thing. These individuals were living under the Roman Empire. Though it wasn't communism, there was enough form of it there that their lives were just completely massacred. No money because of the taxes that had to be paid. So everyone that was looking at Jesus wasn't looking at Jesus from the sense of, you're the Messiah that's here to save us from our sins. They were looking at him as the one that would destroy the Roman Empire. So when he's coming in and they're screaming Hosanna and Hallelujah, everything in their hearts is, you're going to take over Rome. If you could feed 5,000 off of a few fish and a couple of pieces of bread, if you could feed 4,000, if you could raise people from the dead, if you could do all these things like calming a storm, telling it to be still and watching it be still, Rome's nothing. That's Monday. Tuesday, they waited for him to lead the attack on Rome. They gathered. The zealots were thrilled beyond thought, finally. But he didn't attack Rome. Tuesday morning, raised, he walked into the temple and he attacked the Jewish religious system. He cleared the temple out. He threw the money changers out. He threw the sellers of merchandise out. And as he was doing it, he was screaming at them, it is written, my house will be called a house of prayer. You've turned it into a den of robbers. This made no sense in any of their heads. The reason why it made no sense is because they refused to deal with, and we'll deal with that in a moment, they refused to deal with what was really going on. We have seen this story 100 times. You probably grew up in church hearing about Jesus going in and making a whip and driving out everyone out of the temple, yelling this, my house is to be a house of prayer. But if you don't know the historical setting and you don't know what was going on, then you don't understand the story. And by not understanding the story, where they had set up all of the tables to exchange all of the animals, to give money to people, to take money from people, to come in and say, you can't use that money in the temple, you have to use temple money here, so there's an exchange rate. And then they were selling all the little things that they sell, their Chicago Bear flags and everything else for paraphernalia. But the key is where that was all going on. That wasn't going on inside temple where you would think. It was going on in the area that was designed for the Gentiles to come worship. But the Jews didn't give a care about Gentiles. They didn't want them there. These people were vulgar. These people were nasty in their minds. And so they set up everything they did to keep the Gentiles from being able to come to God. And so when Jesus walks in and he makes this whip and he's hollering and screaming and yelling and all of the wussy, wimpy pictures you see of Jesus at his little arms with his long hair, that's not what Jesus looked like. You don't spend 30 years being a carpenter and not look like something with guns on, okay? And so he is intimidating beyond thought. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the priests are scared to death because people are following him and they don't know what to do. And he drives them all out. And the statement that he was making was, these people are way more important than your religious nonsense. And I came to die for everyone. And if you're a brand new Christian, or maybe you're just checking things out, or maybe you've been a born-again believer for a while, anyone in this room Jewish? Okay, so you understand everybody in this room is a Gentile, right? Okay, so if you're not Jewish, you're Gentile. I don't care if you're black, white, green, or in between. If you're not Jewish, you're a Gentile. So he was doing what he was doing for you. He freaks them all out because he doesn't run off Rome. He drives them out. And then he goes back home. And you can picture the crowd and the runners and the zealots standing there. If you don't know what a runner is, it's a guy that goes back and forth with information. They're all freaked out of their minds. What's he doing? He did all this to us instead of to Rome, and now he's gone back and gone to bed. So here comes Wednesday. He's back in the temple, and he's standing there talking, and the crowds are getting bigger and bigger, and the Pharisees and Sadducees and priests are freaking out of their mind. And he starts telling one parable after another. He is teaching them about the kingdom of God, and he is a master teacher. And if every term you've ever heard about a master teacher is some intellectual genius with a doctor's degree at a university, it might, so you'll understand, most master teachers that are called master teachers are master idiots. They're not master teachers. They like hearing themselves talk. So you can understand that everyone that's in church today, would you please say amen?
Amen.
Okay, are you sure? Okay, I was teasing someone back here drinking a Red Bull. I said, we got to have that to stay awake. And they looked at me and they said, I have to drink this to stay awake all the time. I have a job. Hi. This is called a pulpit. I'm on a platform. This is an altar. I'm here to teach. If you guys want to understand what I call bull as a pastor, bull is me spending all of my time talking and you go home and get nothing out of anything that I say. I call that filling up your thimble and then stepping out in the parking lot and spilling it before you go home. If you're a Christian, you're supposed to be changing, you're supposed to be growing, and there's supposed to be something different about you. And I don't care if you come to church and get mad at me, glad at me, or sad with me. You need to walk out of this building knowing that God said something to you and spoke to you specifically, because I have spent the whole stinking week begging God to speak to you. And that's why some of you walk up to me after the service and go, what, was our living room bugged? How did you know what we were talking about? I'm not God. He is. And you guys understand, he hears everything that goes on in your life, right? So he brought you here for a reason today. Some of you have no power. You came here just to get warm. Some of you are sitting here because it's a tradition. Some of you are here because you just decided, I'm just going to go there. Our church is not having church today. There was a few churches without power. But whatever you're here for, you're here for. If I want to be the teacher that God called me to be, that means when you walk out of here, what he has said through me affects you. And what I have to use to do it, I'm going to do it. You guys understand when I move my hands, I do that for a reason? A few of you are sitting right here now going, I don't know. Some of you with OCD tendencies, that just fries your brain. I raise my voice, I lower my voice. I step forward, I harass people in the congregation, pray you're not one of them. I do everything I'm doing for one purpose, so that you walk out of here and God touches your life so you get something. Our master Jesus is a master teacher who everything that he said was to take a thought that they already understood, that's a parable, to take a thought that they already stood, lay it side by side with something so they could go from the unknown to the known or from the known to the unknown, whichever way he was trying to take them. In this case, they're going from the known to the unknown. And there is a lesson that he wants them to get that will be involved in their life for the rest of their lives. Does that make sense to everyone? He also wants to be able to say, hi, I'm speaking to Laura that's sitting in this room today. I'm speaking to Martin that's sitting in this room today. I'm speaking to a beautiful teacher that I love and adore that's sitting in this room today. I'm speaking to individuals that are going through hard times and some that are going through good times. But I have something I want to say. Not just I'm here for tradition. That becomes profound when I look at my Savior and I go, okay, God, I get that part of it. Now tell me what you're up to and tell me what's going on. Okay, so here we go. He said, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a king who prepared a great wedding feast for his son. When the banquet was ready, he sent his servants to notify those who were invited. Stop there. this is a king doing a wedding feast for a son, and he's having this massive banquet, and he wants to invite everyone. So he sends out the invitations to the whole kingdom, the individuals that have been invited. Next line, but they all refuse to come. Okay, we need to go, wait. There's got to be some things that you're dealing with besides you invite people and they don't come. Okay, the first thing that we have to get is the king prepares everything. This is the wedding feast, and the king prepares everything. So he sees that they're not coming, so he sent other servants to tell them. And if you wonder what that other servants mean, how many of you in this room are really good at taking up an offering? You go, what are you talking about? How many of you have noticed the guys that collect the offering, they go down the aisle and they put the plates out? How many of you understand that as human beings, you are manipulable? How many of you understand that? You know, they've done studies across America that if you take the offering plate and make it a half inch deeper, you'll change the offering. If you make it an inch deeper, you'll change it again. Do you know that some people deal the offering, the person that's standing at the end? We used to have a lady in the church that was 6'3". She's the woman that I wanted to take the offering. You go, you've got to be joking and kidding. No, that's who we are and what we are as human beings. So the king, knowing that, says, I sent people to go get people to come, and for some reason, they didn't listen to those people. Okay, look at the guys. Yeah, well, they kind of look a little on the wimpy side, so I'm going to send some bigger dudes to give the announcement this time. So he sends out a whole other group of individuals to go to these people to invite them to come. This becomes super important. He sent other servants to tell them, the feast has been prepared. The bulls and fattened cattle have been killed, and everything is ready. Come to the banquet. Okay, the everything has got to be really important in our Christian lives. You've heard me say this multiple times in church. Everyone in this room that has asked Jesus Christ into their life, would you say amen? Amen. You are saved because of something called grace, not works, right? Right? That's important in the scripture because the king says, I have prepared everything. I've gotten it all ready. You don't have to do anything. You just have to come. He said, the bulls and fat cattle have been killed. How many of you are meat lovers? How many of you a nice cow on a big rotisserie turning in the flame and the fat running stuff off of it? How many of you that makes you speak in tongues? Okay. But so we can be all things to all men. There are some individuals sitting here that are vegans and vegetarians. So the king, being the king the way he was, provided broccoli and green peppers and stuff, okay? See, that's profound because he says the bulls and fattened cattle. Do any of you in this room get a little runny in the mouth when you see a pig on a rotisserie? Robin and I were in Maui. We walked by and they had been roasting a pig. Everything on my insides went, That's exactly what this means. Bulls, one type of meat. Fattened cattle, another type of meat. And so these two different things have been prepared. In other words, I've gone all out to get this thing ready for you. The king prepares everything, not us. This is really difficult on us. This is hard because we're works oriented. If I think that by doing something I can make God happy, and that's just a really good commercial. Does everyone in this room understand that God loves you? Does everyone understand God loves you? Amen. Everyone in this room that's got a little bit of jackass in them, would you please say amen? Amen. Does he still love you? Amen. Anyone that screwed up this last week, does he still love you? Amen. Does God look down at you and go, you screwed up this week. You didn't have power and you stood out in the backyard cussing your full head off. I don't love you anymore. No, that's not God. Thank you that that's not God. He looks at me and says, I still love you. And so this king says to everyone, I have everything ready. So number two, everyone gets invited. But the guest he invited ignored them and went their own way. One to his farm, that's where my farmer comes from. Another to his business, that's the other dudes. Please don't miss this. He invited the farmer, the business person, and even the ones who seized his messengers and insulted them and killed them. That beats all I've ever seen in my whole life, that an individual being invited to a wedding would seize a messenger and insult him or then kill him. But I live in a country called America that is changing rapidly. And it used to be in the country that I lived in, Christianity was respected. Have you now noticed that Christianity and Jesus Christ are one of the things are the butt of almost all jokes? You notice that? I was watching a program out of Australia the other day. There were like six or seven people on the panel, and there was one individual that was a drag queen on the panel. And what came out of his mouth joke-wise about my Jesus and my Savior, he's very blessed that I wasn't there because I would have laid hands on him in the name of Jesus. What came out of his mouth was beyond vulgar. And you know what annoys the living snot out of me? It annoys me that that piece of garbage could sit at that table and know, if you're new with me and you've never heard someone say that, that piece of garbage, trash, vulgar, nasty human being. My Jesus loves him just as much as he loves me. Do you get that? I watched the news the other day and watched the guy stand on the street corner trying to figure out how to get his gun loaded, and he finally got it loaded to point it at the head of a street person and blow his brains out. And some piece of garbage human being set up in the building filming it. The human up there filming it and the guy that was putting the gun together to shoot the man are low-life pieces of trash. Do you know Jesus loves them just as much as he loves me? Do you know Jesus doesn't look at them one bit different than he does Frank? He said their sin and my sin's all the same. The moment I start feeling superior, that's the nonsense that goes on in so many of our churches. The moment I start feeling superior to another human being, I am out of line. I am not where I'm supposed to be because my Jesus loved all mankind. And if I go back in time, that includes every dog that was part of the Nazi army. That includes Hitler himself. It includes one garbage human after another that I look at and call trash that my Jesus looks at and says, I died for that person. I'm sorry, I'm a human. That makes no sense to me. How many of you on a semi-daily basis run into stupid people? You ever notice they test your spiritual gifts and your anger? And you sit there going, what, do you take pills to get this dumb? Isn't it amazing that Jesus loves them? See, what's really cool about that is if I can get it in my head that he invited everyone, then I can get it in my head that my Savior looked at me and said, hold, Frank, I don't want you to miss this. The guests were indifferent. Some of them opposed, point number three, some of them opposed, and some of them are unchanged. We'll deal with the unchanged part in a moment. But these people were indifferent. Some of them flat opposed. And I still loved them. I'm a human. I go, oh, yuck. Why would you do that? We'll have that answered before we're done. The thing that's rough is the farmer, the business people, and the individuals that insulted and killed individuals, number four, they all suffered the same fate. The king was furious. He sent out his army to destroy the murderers and burn their town. Station break. The king was furious and he sent out his army to destroy the murderers and burn their town. You understand all the symbolism there. This is a story that he's telling the Pharisees, Sadducees, and the priests, and every Jew that's standing there listening to him, and the few Gentiles that they have led in the area. He's looking at every single one of them and saying, the king invited, they rejected, he became furious, he sent out his army to destroy them and burn their town to the ground. That is symbolism about a God that says, I will put people in hell. That's a terminology that's gone out of American culture. Boy, I'm old enough to remember it because it's what I started doing. Can you imagine me preaching at 11 years of age? I was a hellfire and brimstone preacher. How many of you have ever heard of a hellfire and brimstone preacher? Just tear the town up. The biggie that they're almost all noted for is yelling at people that if you've not accepted Christ into your life, you're going to go where? Oh, let's try it again. See, you can't even say that word. If you've not asked Jesus Christ into your life, you're going to go where? Okay, you understand that hell is not a bad word. It's a bad place, right? Okay, and it doesn't give you the right to go, oh, hell. Okay, that's not what we're talking about. Everybody understand? See, this, we've ixnayed this in our conversation. Our government and our social spectrum and our education system has screamed at us so long that we have spiraled down. And the majority of the pastors in our country, I'm sorry, God, the majority of the pastors in our country don't have the guts to say what needs to be said anymore. We squawk and mouth off about homosexuality and transgenderism and Black Lives Matter and all this other nonsense. We yell like a house of fire, but we don't ever stop and go, hi, gay dude, I love you. And if you don't ask Jesus Christ into your life, you're going to go to hell. What I just said in the United States of America is considered hate speech. Because I dared to look at someone and say, you're going to go to hell. Ready? If you've not asked Jesus Christ into your life, you will go to hell. That's not talked about anymore. You can't even get it at a funeral home. Go to a funeral home. They have little plaques up all over the place that say wonderful little things about, you know, so-and-so's dead and gone, but they're now an angel watching over you. No, they're not. If they were an angel watching over you, they'd slap the snot out of you regularly. They're not an angel. They're either standing before a holy God, eating the best food and having a blast and having a whole section of heaven that there's no cats in it. They're enjoying themselves in the Lord. They're praising a holy God, or they're in hell screaming their lungs out. A or B. And it can tick you off, and it can bother you, and it can upset you. But when Jesus told the story, he looked at the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the high priest and all the priests standing there and every Jew and Gentile standing there. And he said, if you reject my invitation, the king will come and burn you to the ground. There wasn't no softy stuff. There wasn't this thing that goes on in our culture and our society about, well, that's not very loving what you just said. That word everyone has powerful meaning. Number five, now go out to the street corners and invite everyone you see. So the servants brought in everyone that they could find, good and, what's the next word? How many of you are glad he went looking for the bad? How many of you qualify as the bad? You got a whole bunch of you just liars. Let's try it again. How many of you qualify as bad? You're raised in a culture where you were taught, well, you're a good little boy. You attend church every once in a while. You go, you're rude. Yes. Because I love you. Servants brought in everyone they could find, good and bad. And the banquet hall was filled with guests. Good and bad. They filled the place up. And everyone sat around having a drink together and eating great food and dancing. How many of you love going to weddings? How many of you, that's the only time you dance is when you go to a wedding? How many of you, that's the only time you dance is when you go to a wedding? Amanda Edwards, does your husband ever dance when he goes to a wedding, ever? Just once? Yeah. Every time I go to a wedding, we're all out there boogieing away, and I look over and Adam Edwards just sitting there nodding his head. How many, when you go to a wedding, you never dance? You never, ever dance. How many of you are a no dancer? How many of you know how stupid you look when you're at a wedding dancing? If you want to know how dumb you look, get someone to film it, and then go home and play the film without the music. I don't care how bad you think you look. No music, you look stupid, okay? But the key is, you're having a blast. And you're having fun. And everybody at this wedding was doing the little, you know, thing that they do as Jewish brothers, you know, and they're little, you know, and they're all having a blast. And they're drinking wine, and they're eating some really great food, and people are just in total celebration mode, and they're looking over there, and there's so-and-so, one of the greatest people in town, you know, and they look over there, and there's one of the worst human beings that ever lived. And they're like, what are they doing here? And you're not. You might be, but...
But there all of these people, good and bad, they're all sitting there, and the room's crammed, packed. This is what God wants. Hi. Welcome to Church 101. God wants His house full. It's not done by me. Respectfully, I'll do my level best to keep you awake while you're here. I'll do my best to teach you something you need to hear before you walk out of here. But it's you. Do you know how many people attend this church that the reason why they're sitting here is because one of you told them about it? You get people that walk in the building all the time and look at me and says, yeah, I was at the hospital talking to somebody and I was talking about church and needing a church and the nurse said, oh, I know where you got to go. You got to go to Oakwood. You go to Oakwood? Nope. It's the best church. You got to go there. It's you. And so all these people at the wedding, all these servants were out doing their job. They were inviting. And they were inviting everyone. Stop. Because this is where we run into a struggle. Everyone's invited. But number six, great responsibility comes with receiving great grace. When God offers you salvation, that grace, that's an unmerited favor. It's something that's given to you that you didn't earn. But with that comes great responsibility. It's not just a freebie. This is the system that we run in American culture and European culture. It's not biblical. It says when the king came in to meet the guest, he noticed a man who wasn't wearing the proper clothes for a wedding. This is when I said back in the thing earlier, the unchanged person. This is the unchanged guy at the wedding. That doesn't fit into our belief system. We have a culture that we've accepted versus what's called real culture. When we receive this grace from God that we become a born-again believer, it comes with responsibility. It means that I'm supposed to understand that I'm not just accepting a Savior, I am also accepting a Lord. So when Frank asked Christ into his life and he came into my heart, he changed me. Everyone understand that? Does everyone understand that? Okay, this is imperative. It's not, I don't get to make it up as I go along. I don't get to sit here and say, it's like when Pilate looked at Jesus and he said, what is truth? He didn't understand the tongue-in-cheek thing that was going on. He's looking at Jesus, truth, and asking the question, what is truth? He's looking at God-man and saying, what's truth? And this God-man that was truth is also God, which is love. And you can't take truth and you can't take love and pull them apart from each other. And that's who he was asking the question of. The problem with truth is, it's not always factual. It doesn't fit into the world of our reason. The reason why it doesn't, the problem that we deal with truth, we start dealing with truth and we start wanting to deal with doctrinal statements. We want to start dealing with rules. Truth is so powerful and so large and so fathomless that it created the universe with a word. Truth stands outside of time and space. Truth is a person. It's not rules and regulations. It's a Savior. It's a Lord. It's a Master. He is alive and He is eternal. He's God. So when I say I believe in the truth, I'm talking about Jesus Christ. When I say I believe in love, I'm talking about Him. And that truth and that love can't be pulled apart from each other. Respectfully, and I say it with due respect, does everyone understand what I just said? Because we struggle with this as Christians. We've listened for so long to individuals telling us, yeah, you need to show more love. The world can be won if you would just show more love. Do you guys know the fastest growing religion in America? Which one it is? It's Islam. The strictest, nastiest, orneriest, vulgar, I don't have a problem, this is being recorded, doesn't bug me at all. The most blatantly against God thing that is out there is growing the fastest. It's growing the fastest because Christians are making the mistake of thinking that people just want love, and they don't understand that people want something that they can anchor their life into and that can guide them and direct them. Do you understand that? God is a triune being. That's truth. There's all kind of organizations today, including T.D. Jakes and others, that are getting up and saying, no, 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 God's not a Trinity. He just kind of morphs into one thing and another. Jesus died for our sins. That's kind of hard. That's kind of rough. You know, that's kind of morbid. You know, we need a God that's more understanding. He was born of a virgin. Oh, yeah, right, sure, excuse me. You're telling me that Joseph and Mary didn't get it on? Got caught, so they made up some really cute story that this was of God. Famous truth. He's the only way to God. Everyone that understands that Jesus Christ is the only way to God, would you please say amen?
Amen.
Well, this is really important you get this, because that's going to come under fire more and more. It already is. Christians are already taking flack because we believe he's the only way. But the instant you say that he's the only way, you just excluded all Hindus and Muslims and all these other folks, correct? So you're bombarded and you're attacked in our culture because you dare to say that. The thing that's funny is, if you go study Hindus, and if you go study Confucius, and if you go study the Islamic boys, every single one of them are more exclusive than Christians are. Just no one talks about that. And if you don't know why they don't talk about it, you only attack the truth. You don't attack a lie. So they make fun of Jesus because they wouldn't dare make fun of Allah. They make fun of our Savior, and we stop and get our feathers in a ruffle and don't ever stop and go, wait, 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 time out. Another truth, sin is sin. We can't even define sin anymore. Have you noticed in our culture that almost everything out there is no longer sin? We used to look at people and say that guy's a sexual pervert. Now it's almost like sitting down and saying, oh, no, 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 he has a disease. I listen to Christians all the time. I want to avoid controversy. I don't want to hear sermons like this. Where's the I really need to be cool? Remember, God said that we're to be at peace with all people, so we're scared to death to open our mouth to say anything. We're afraid that we're going to be pushing and not accepting. It's just a theological question. If you're not pushing the truth, and you're still talking about Jesus, do you understand you're pushing a watered-down, no-repentance, no-salvation gospel? Do you understand that? How many of you grew up hearing the story about the emperor with no clothes? Why did it take a little kid in the crowd to look at the emperor and go, you're naked? I ask a deeper question. Why at a wedding, when people were walking around in wedding clothing, did no one walk up to the guy that was standing there and go, before the king came out, you don't have the right clothes on? How many of you understand in Michigan it's winter? How many of you understand it? Just I want to know. In Michigan it's winter. How many of you understand that? Okay, did you dress accordingly? I'm getting amazed at Christians. We went through an ice storm the other day, went through 10 inches of snuff the day after that. Do you know how many Christians think the apocalypse is here? And now we're dealing with 75-degree weather today. This is Michigan, right? When do we sit down and say, wait a minute, wait, 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 wait. God looked at us and said, I gave my son to die for you. I became God-man to die for you. And yes, it's free. But you have to accept it. And when you accept it, you have to repent. Repent of what? Why do I get in trouble in this culture if I stand up and say something is a sin? In our culture, you're not married, you're sleeping with somebody, you're having sex with somebody, God's word says that's sin. Do you know I have Christians that spaz out of their brains because I said that? In the first pages of the book of Genesis, the Bible declares that God created us male and female. Everyone in this room that's a female, would you please say amen?
Amen.
Everyone that's a male, would you say amen?
Amen.
You guys sure? I don't care how many times you say, I feel like a woman. You're still a guy. And in this culture where that's being hotly contested, and anyone that gets up and goes, excuse me, Jack, yo, roosters can't lay eggs and men don't have wombs, okay? Automatically, somebody and their brother freaks right out of their mind. If I can give you something to help you, let them freak out of their mind. Let them. I walked into Briarwood Mall the other day. I walked into the men's restroom. I took one step in the door, I looked at the wall, and there was a tampon machine there. And I went, whoop, wrong bathroom. And I ran out, because there's nothing worse than being a pastor and one of your church members sees you coming out of a women's restroom, okay? It's not good on the name. And I step out and look around, nobody sees me. I go, oh, thank you, God. And I walk over to go in the other bathroom, and there's a W on the door. I can spell, okay? And I went, what? So I look back at the door I just walked in, and there's an M on the door. I open the door, walk in, there's a tampon machine, and I walk over, and there's urinals. How many of you understand this is a really great time to preach a sermon? So I step right back out in the little area and look around. 8 or 9 people there. What is wrong with people? Ask my son, he was with me. I walked into the shoe store with, that's the exact same thing coming out of my mouth. What is wrong with people? You go, you're not very loving. Hi. I was raised in a culture where stupid is stupid. And everybody that gets upset, well, you need to be more loving. You won't get an opportunity to introduce Jesus to people by being a butt. I call it butt evangelism. But the right butt. I sit down and look at people and say, just like he said, that's a sin. Quit. Hi, I love you. I have never mistreated anyone over sin, but I have looked at people and said, that's immoral, that's wrong, that's vulgar, and you need to change. Well, you're no better than me. You're dang right I'm no better than you. And I needed a Jesus just like you do. Same way you do. The only difference is you're not running into one of those idiots, because it's so easy to do. We can get so into the truth that we forget the love part of it. And we can get so into love that we forget the truth part of it. And it's supposed to be a balance. I'm supposed to say, Frank, you can't do that. It's wrong. It's immoral. And I'm supposed to hold myself at a certain place that I'm supposed to be as a Christian. But I'm supposed to look at other individuals and say, you can't do that. Having a cat in your home is a sin. Grow up in God. The Bible says God created angels, and one of them became Satan, and Satan's first creation was a cat. And you go, that's not what the Bible says. Have you read the whole Bible? Until you have read the whole Bible, shut up. Once you've got it read, you can tell me if I'm right or wrong. Until then, be quiet and get rid of your cats. Watch it. You probably read that New Age version. Okay, here. We're back. Why didn't someone walk up to him and say, you have the wrong outfit on? Why didn't someone have the guts to say, I love you enough to look at you and say, you're dressed wrong? This is Michigan. We wear clothes to stay warm, unless your name is Mike Pickrell. Then you wear shorts and t-shirts. The dude at this wedding was with shorts and t-shirts and sandals. And the king walked up and said, where's the wedding clothes? Why didn't someone look at him before and say, hey man, I love you. Why are you not dressed like you're supposed to be? The king's going to be coming in a minute and you don't have the right clothes on. He would have gone, no, the king's loving, he understands, he's not going to have a problem. See, number seven, to accept the invitation is to accept change. Friend, he asked, how is it that you're here without wedding clothes? And I love the next sentence. The man had no reply. He knew he was wrong. We know when we're wrong. The world knows it's wrong. Suicide, alcoholism, drug addiction, it's off the chart in this society. Why? Because people know they're wrong. And they can't shut the voice up in their heart and their head. They try to blame it on Christians and say it's because Christians keep saying that stuff's sin. I'm sorry. There's only a few churches in the United States of America that stand up and call things sin anymore. They can go to any church in town and have a little gay flag and all the other stuff they want, and no one will say a word. That's not why they're doing what they're doing. That's not why they're committing suicide. And if some stinking teacher tells your teenager that at school, go sit down with the teacher and ask for the facts that prove that. Because what they're really finding from the Christian psychologist and secular psychologist and psychiatrist that are working with these individuals, it's because they can't shut the guilt up inside their heart. They need Jesus. And if we don't tell them about Jesus, if we let their lifestyle repulse us, if we say they're not like us, if we run from the world instead of running to it to say, let me help you put out the fire, then they're going to get this. The king said to his aides, bind his hands and his feet and throw him into outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That is a very nice way of saying, put him in hell. And I don't want that for anyone. If you wonder why I major on to accept the invitation is to accept change, is because number eight, change is the sign. If you can look at me real quick as I close this. If you want to know if you're a born-again believer, has Satan ever attacked you with doubt? You ever gotten attacked with doubt? I love my Bible study group Thursday evening. That was beyond awesome. I'm sitting in a group with 16 or 17 guys, and we're in this whole discussion, and we're in 2 Corinthians, the last chapter, and the last chapter is where Paul says, test yourself to see if you're in the faith. I have taught that section of Scripture or something there like it probably a couple of hundred times in my ministry. Almost every time I've ever taught it, every group sitting there, how do you know for sure that you know Christ? Almost without fail, I'm reading my Bible, I'm praying, I'm going to church, I'm giving, and none of those things is a sign that you know Jesus. And respectfully, because they're all here, a whole bunch of them are staring at me right now. Respectfully, every one of those knuckleheads in that group just blew my mind. Because every one of them in that group didn't go there. They went to where we're supposed to go. If you want to know if you know Jesus, it comes from the inside out. You see humility growing in your life. You see righteousness growing in your life. You see obedience growing in your life. You see submissiveness growing in your life, and you see love growing in your life. You want to know if you know Jesus? You start loving the unloving individuals. You want to know if you know Jesus? There's things that you used to do that you're not doing, and it's not because you're following rules. It's because something inside of you goes and just makes you change. He said, you don't have the right garb on. It was symbolism for your standing someplace, not being what you're supposed to be if you've been called. That's why the verse that he said was, many are called, but few are chosen. It throws Calvinism right out the door. Calvinism believes that only certain people are called. Your Bible says many are called. In fact, he said in Scripture his desire that all would be saved. The problem is you're either stuck in Calvinism or Arminianism, which is what I am. I'm an individual that believes he calls and I have the choice to answer. Well, the problem with that choice is it puts a whole bunch of responsibility and then it goes the wrong way. I have to understand that I don't understand him. How many of you have gotten it figured out that you don't understand everything about God? God just says, hi. I called. You came. If you were chosen, you want to know if you're chosen? Do you change? Do you become a different human being? And I'm sorry, a few of you will take major offense. It's okay, be offended. You can gripe about me all afternoon. Your jackassism becomes less jackassism. Does that make sense? You become a different human being, and you can't stop it. He's inside of you. And he starts moving and changing and making you different and making you loving and making you submissive and making you righteous and making you humble. Because he's inside and he's your king and he's your God and he's your master and you're his servant and you're his child. He said, son, you have the wrong clothes on. You're not one. You have the right clothes on today. Let's go to the Lord together, please. Father, I thank you so very much for being here with us today. And I thank you for everything we've talked about. I thank you for everything that's been said. I thank you that you're King and that you're God and that you're real. I thank you that years ago, you touched my heart and you called me. And I accepted. And I thank you for every person in this room that's done that. But Master, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that there are people in this world that have never met you. That becomes our responsibility, God. Help us to walk out of this building. Find that one person that you want us to reach. Whether it's on our college campus, whether it's in our school, whether it's in our family, whether it's a friend, or whether it's the guy that we met at the gas station. Let us be that light that gives that invitation to bring that person to you. We ask this in your name, Lord. Amen.
Amen. His word never fails. Amen. Amen. All throughout the times of this world, they've tried to stop his word, and his word prevails. That's what the word of God says. We got one more song to sing, so why don't you stand to your feet today?
Jesus, you brought heaven down.
praise your name, Lord. Oh, how good you are. We're gonna give you all our praises. We're gonna sing of who you are. 'Cause death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. And you have no rival.
Come on.
And you have no equal. And now and forever, God, you reign. And yours is the kingdom. And yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names.
What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name.
What a beautiful name it is.
His praise. We exalt your name. Thank you, Lord. Hey, guys, we got a chili cook-off today in a variety show. We're so excited. Don't miss the chance to fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. You don't have to make chili. I think you do have to bring either desserts or some type of side. Am I correct with that, Mike? Okay, he shook his head yes. Usually he yells something sarcastic. I'm waiting. No, he's good. Okay. So, anyways, but we're doing that. 5 o'clock, get there at 4:30 to get your stuff signed in. If you're in the talent show, I'd like you to be there around 4:30 as well to get a sound check if you are able to. But go be the church. You are dismissed. We love you so much.